It is indeed a pleasure to be here and to be part of this lectureship again this year. It is a pleasure always to be with this congregation. I have worked with the congregation in a number of capacities over the years, and as I look about the auditorium this afternoon, I recognize a lot of faces, and I appreciate all of you. I'm not sure I appreciate the time that you've given me to speak this afternoon. I remember on another occasion in Idaho, I was on a lectureship, and the director of the lectureship gave this long, drawn-out explanation for the fact that I was speaking right after lunch, and that all of us needed to stay awake and be alert and all of this. When I came to the end of my lecture that day, he was asleep. He was so sound asleep that somebody behind him had to punch him 3 times to get him to move up. I hope that doesn't happen today, David. That's up to me. When we look at the 7 churches of Asia and the letters that Jesus wrote to these churches, we get a glimpse or a snapshot of what congregations can be like. I think it should be a sobering study for us to recognize that these congregations were real congregations, that they existed in the first century. And even though sometimes we have the tendency to think that only we have to deal with problems in the church, it's obvious in reading these 7 letters to the 7 churches of Asia and all of the epistles that we find in the New Testament that we're not the only ones that had to deal with error. And we're not the only ones that have to deal with people who are willing to accommodate and tolerate error. For it happened in the first century. And we should not be surprised, nor should we tolerate things that God does not tolerate, as indicated in His Word. We have a challenge in front of us. And these congregations give us snapshots into what congregations can look like. But we also need to recognize that any one of these congregations could change. We could take the case of a congregation that was not condemned in any way, but upheld by the Lord. And we should recognize that as time goes by, that congregation can change and accept things that God will not tolerate. So it behooves us to be watchful. It requires of us a watchfulness to the teachings of God's Word, lest we let them slip. It is also the case that as we notice some of these congregations who were doing things and believing things and accepting things that they ought not, that those congregations could change. These are simply current snapshots of the congregations to whom Jesus was writing at the time. And in fact, in those cases where sin was in the congregation, Jesus demanded their repentance. He did not turn a blind eye to the things that were going on there, but rather called upon them to change and to repent and to be what He wanted them to be. And if we learn anything at all from these studies, it ought to be the fact that we ought to always use as our direction, our compass, spiritually speaking, the Word of God, And when we veer to the left or veer to the right, or we simply ignore the directions of life, we need to get back to the truth. We need to realize that nothing in this life is permanent. And if we're sinning, we need to repent and get back to doing what's right. Every congregation of God's people is known by the Lord for something. Brother Bruce mentioned in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 the qualities that were present in the church in Thessalonica. Listen to them again. 1 Thessalonians 1 and verse 3. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith. What about the congregation where you are? Would it be known because of your work of faith? And labor of love. What about that? And patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Think about it for a minute. Where you worship, where you serve, where you work for the Lord. What kind of things does the Lord notice about the congregation of which you are part? The churches of Asia, many of them had fellowship problems. We have fellowship problems. And oftentimes it is a lot easier not to deal with them. It is a lot more comfortable not to deal with the fellowship issues that exist. But it's never right to ignore them and refuse to deal with them. It's interesting that we have no record of the beginning of the church in Pergamos. We can't look back to the pages of the New Testament and find out exactly when the church there was established. We can't, for example, go to the book of Acts and read of the beginning of the church in Pergamos. But the church was present there, maybe the result of some who had been converted on the day of Pentecost, who went back home with the message of the gospel of Christ. Or perhaps it was a result of the teaching of Paul in the school of Tyrannus in Ephesus for more than 2 years, where all of Asia learned of the gospel of Christ, both Jew and Gentile. Acts chapter 19, verses 9 and 10. But however the congregation was established there, it was established there. And Jesus chooses this congregation as one of the ones to whom he sends a letter of praise and a letter of rebuke. Pergamos was the headquarters at this time of emperor worship, where men and women were called upon to worship Caesar instead of worshiping God. That's the kind of place Pergamos was. It was a place in which we find many who came at that time to be healed. Medicine was deified in the city of Pergamos. In Pergamos, there was also the mining of a white stone that was so unusual and so valuable that it was used on occasion to give to those that were acquitted of a crime, or to a freed slave when the slave became a citizen, or winners of races, or victorious warriors. It was the location of a noted library, second only to Alexandria. And there was kind of a rivalry between Pergamos and Alexandria, to the extent that papyrus was used on the books of the library And Alexandria prevented Pergamos from having any of that material to have books. And so they came up with parchment. And the word parchment comes from the word Pergamos. But notice here in this letter to the church at Pergamos that Jesus writes in a very clear fashion to this church. He writes concerning a sword that is two-edged. And he writes concerning himself as being that sword. Let's read that text in Revelation 2, beginning in verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges. I know thy works and where thou dwellest. Now listen, even where Satan's seat is. And thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which things I hate. Repent, or else I come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth saving he that receiveth it. So Jesus begins by referring to himself as having this sword that cuts both ways. These people were familiar with the Roman sword. It was a sword of offense and a sword of defense. I like what Brother Frank Cox said about this statement. He says, being two-edged, it cuts two ways, convicts man of sin, also of righteousness, converts some and condemns others, saves all who accept it, and slays all who reject it. Now, that terminology, as applied to the word of the Lord, may not sit too well with liberal brethren who believe that God and Christ are only loving and kind and sweet and all of this. But notice Jesus' terminology suggests to us very clearly that there is a weapon in the word of his mouth that can condemn sin and protect the righteous. And he means business. He's not playing around. He understands the seriousness of the situation. And so with this sharp two-edged sword, mindful of the fact in Hebrews 4 and verse 12, that the word of God is described as living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, he comes to these brethren with these things in mind concerning God's appraisal, Christ's appraisal of the congregation there in Pergamos. In fact, it goes on to say in verse 16, I will come quickly, those that do not repent. He says, I will come quickly and will war against them with the sword of my mouth. I think that to be a dangerous place for any of us to be in. to receive the sword of the mouth of the Lord because of our refusal to do what is right. Jesus says to this congregation, I know thy works. And he knows our works. And he knows the works of the congregations of which we are part. There is nothing hidden from the Lord. He knows what we are about. I think of a statement made in Revelation 14, verse 13, where those that have died as blessed and faithful in the Lord are said concerning them that their works do follow them. We can't take material things into eternity. But what we can take into eternity and what we will take into eternity is our works. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10, Paul said, but we must all be made manifest before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the deeds done in the body according to what he hath done, whether it be good or evil. When we go into judgment day, we're going to take with us our works, whether they are good or whether they're bad. God knows what we do. That's true of individuals. Individuals, as we stand before the judgment seat of Christ on that day, will give an account concerning what we as individuals have done. But brethren, this statement here of the Lord indicates that we need to be concerned also about the congregation of which we're part. He knows our works collectively as well as individually. And we should be concerned about being part of a faithful congregation and being concerned also about maintaining that faithfulness in our service to God. Jesus says in this letter, he that hath an ear, let him hear. Let him hear. That means more than just sitting where you are now and listening to someone speak the word of God. It means once having heard the word of God, we do like James tells us to do, be doers of the word and not hearers only. We cannot go to heaven simply on the basis of the number of times that we've been in the assembly of the church and heard the word of God preached and give mental assent to the things that we've heard. We need to understand that we're going to have to apply to our lives. We're going to have to take heed to the things that we hear in order that we might be pleasing to him. Jesus says to the church at Pergamos, to him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna and give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name is written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. I think of the name of Christ and the name Christian. In Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, we're told, there is no other name under heaven given among men wherein we must be saved. That name of Christ ought to mean something to us. Not simply a name, but a name in which there is salvation. A name that indicates authority and the submission that we have to that authority. In Colossians chapter 3 and verse 17, Paul said, whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a glorious name. A name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Both of things in heaven and on earth. There's that new name. And to be called a Christian, to be Christ-like, the signifying of that term. In Acts chapter 11 and verse 26, the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. What a blessed privilege it is to be called a Christian and to be a Christian and to be under the authority of Christ in all things. The reward is going to be great for all of those who are faithful in our service to Him. And He calls upon us to render obedience to His word. There is praise, therefore, in the letter that Jesus writes to the church at Pergamos. Praise for their faithfulness. He says to them, "Thou holdest fast my name, the name which is above every name." That doesn't mean just having the name Christ on the front of a church building. It means recognizing His supreme authority and wearing His name because we walk in His way. In John 14, verse 6, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me." So Jesus says to this church, "Thou holdest fast to my name." It is not something that we can just kind of shrug our shoulders and get by. It is something that we need to hold fast to. We need to make that deliberate effort to hold fast to the name of Christ and all the name of Christ implies. Hold fast to His word. Hold fast to His authority. Submit ourselves to Him. And the church at Pergamos was doing that. "Thou holdest fast my name." He also says to the church there, "Thou hast not denied my faith." So here were individuals who were willing to stand the test of persecution, of hardship, of difficulties in life, and they held fast to the faith which is in Jesus Christ. They walked by faith and not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 7. But notice also this. This was done in spite of their location, which is described by Jesus now as where Satan's seat, his throne is, and where Satan dwelleth. I can understand that terminology. Sometimes I feel like that's where I am, in Denver, Colorado. Sometimes I'm ashamed to even tell somebody I'm from Colorado. But wherever we live, whether it is Houston or some other place, there are always evidences of the power and control of Satan over the lives of people. Listen, brethren, Jesus describes this congregation as having been faithful, holding fast to His name, even though they were in a bad location. In other words, He's telling us, a congregation can be started and people can be faithful to God even in the worst of outward conditions. Doesn't say it's going to be easy. But we can stand for the truth if we stand alone. No matter what kind of weapon Satan may shoot our way, we can be faithful to God even in bad places. The congregation of Pergamos shows us that that's possible. We can hold fast to the name of Christ. We can remain faithful to Him, even where Satan's throne is and where Satan dwelleth. So don't tell me that it's impossible to remain faithful in a high school that is full of atheistic, materialistic, sinful individuals. You can be faithful to God no matter where you are. It's not going to be easy, but we can be faithful to God. Notice also in the church at Pergamos that there was one at least, maybe more, who had been killed because of their faith in Christ. Jesus gives him the name Antipas. He calls him my faithful martyr. And we don't know whether Antipas was an actual individual, or because of the meaning of the term itself, it may simply have been a reference to martyrs in general in that place. But we're not talking about just persecution. We're talking about someone who died because of his convictions in the Lord. He chose imposed death in righteousness rather than a longer life at the expense of truth and service. Reminds us of an earlier letter written by Jesus in which he said in Revelation 2 verse 10, "Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life." I oftentimes think of the difficulties that I face in living the Christian life. And then I read in the pages of Scripture of others who gave far much more than I have, endured far much more than I have. I oftentimes think of Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 32. Listen to what these folks were going through. "But call to remembrance," verse 32, "but call to remembrance the former days in which, after ye were illuminated, you endured a great fight of afflictions, partly whilst you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly whilst ye became companions of them that were so used. For ye had compassion of me in my bonds, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance. Cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul." I don't think any of us could claim that someone has broken into our house and taken our possessions because of our allegiance to Jesus Christ. I don't think any of us have ever experienced being a gazing stock, put in stocks before people and allowed them to say all kinds of things against us and about us and call us names, hold us up for public ridicule, and maybe spit in our faces and the like, beat us with rods. And these people to whom this inspired writer states these things, he says you have need of endurance. You have need of patience. Wow. But they remain faithful to the Lord. And in so doing, they will receive a rich reward from God in heaven. But then Jesus turns to reproof or rebuke of these brethren in Pergamos. Their problem was the toleration of false teachers. In other words, their failure to discipline those who would teach false doctrine and those who would listen and heed to false doctrine. Jesus says to the church in Pergamos, "Thou hast there some that hold the doctrine of Balaam." Notice the word "some." Not all the congregation was this way. But there were some within the congregation at Pergamos that held to the doctrine of Balaam. And you remember Balaam. He was a prophet who was concerned about the wages of unrighteousness. And he caused the people of Israel to eat things sacrificed unto idols and to commit fornication. His donkey had to rebuke him. But here was a man who, for profit, was willing to teach and to preach and proclaim whatever Balak wanted him to say. We have people like that today, don't we? It's amazing how that this passage out of the book of Numbers and the events of that situation are referred to a number of times in the pages of the New Testament. It is the case that oftentimes the same kinds of issues occur generation after generation, and we always have to deal with them. And so here were some in the church at Pergamos who held to the doctrine of Balaam, and some of them held to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. And we don't know all the details of these doctrines, but the summation of these doctrines is found in the words of Jesus again here in Revelation 2. He says, "Which things I hate." You know, we have a problem sometimes in the way we feel about things. Sometimes we feel good about things that are really not that good. And sometimes we feel bad about things which are really pretty good. But hear this and hear this well. We need to understand that if God hates something, we need to hate it too. The problem in the church at Pergamos was that they loved what God hated, and they headed backwards. And there are some things very clearly stated in the Bible that God hates. And we better find ourselves in a situation in which we hate those very things that God hates. And whatever the details of these false doctrines were, they were clearly false doctrines. They were not the doctrine of Christ. They were not abiding in the doctrine of Christ, 2 John verses 9 through 11. But these were doctrines that were separate and apart from the teachings of God's word. And there were those in Pergamos, for one reason or another, who were holding on to these doctrines. And there were those in the congregation in Pergamos who were allowing that to happen without any kind of reproof or rebuke. I realize that there are some who would suggest to us this afternoon that here is an open-minded congregation who is willing to accept all kinds of doctrines, and broad-minded enough to accept them. And they suggest that that's okay. But they don't get that idea from the writings of the New Testament, and especially from the writings of Jesus here to the church at Pergamos. It may be the case that they are currently accepting those that teach false doctrine. But that doesn't mean that God will allow them to continue accepting that false doctrine and approve of that kind of situation. Listen again to what Jesus says to the church at Pergamos. He states very clearly that he has a weapon in hand and he hates these false doctrines. And he is going to come with the sword of his mouth, this two-edged sword, and he is going to make war. War is an ugly thing, but sometimes necessary to root out the cause of the problem. And Jesus says, I'm going to do battle against these folks unless they repent. Now hear that unless they repent. He's going to give them time and opportunity to repent, but you can rest assured if there is no repentance, there is going to be holy war from Jesus against these very ones, not only the ones that teach the false doctrine, but those who have failed to discipline them, to reprove and rebuke them, and bring them back to the truth. When false doctrine enters a congregation, it must be immediately exposed as error. The more time that passes and error is tolerated, the more difficult it becomes to root it out and to get rid of it. Error must be opposed and exposed before it moves into a congregation. Therefore, we need to know what's going on elsewhere in order to prevent it from coming to where we are and causing problems from within. Jesus declared, "Which things I hate." In Psalm 119:104, the psalmist says, "Through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore I hate," there's that word again, "every false way." Toleration of error will allow sin to permeate the entire congregation, and therefore it needs to be stopped. And Jesus calls upon them not to continue their toleration of error, but to repent, or else I will come to thee quickly and will war against them with the sword of my mouth. That's a no-win situation. We need to be on our guard. We need to uphold the truth, the Word of God. Thank you.